Okay, so open and government basically take two completely separate problems of companies moving to, formally to tax havens and companies moving physically to developing countries, saying, oh, but if we fuse those two problems into one big domestic problem, we're going to solve both of them. That's basically their case. I'm going to get to how that's basically their case, but you can do faces anyway. When they say we don't want to take money to maintain domestic jobs, what they're saying is, so instead we're going to give up money on jobs that we agree are going to die, and they agree that it's going to take crazy tax breaks because of the massive wage gaps, and because tax havens are an existing thing that you have to commit with. So Hila basically concedes that if it's super crazy difference, then it doesn't matter, but if it's only like a pretty crazy difference, then it might matter, right? At which point, you're giving up so many tax breaks that it's unclear what is all this massive influx of money that they say they will have on their side. Oh, okay. So. At which point, even if it's true, they concede most of their benefits, if not all of them. But I'm going to talk about how this actually affects people. Both of them said that a lot spoke about it, wasn't engagement on pollution, the taxing of local domestic infrastructure, and second, on how this actually affects jobs, why it prevents retraining. I'm going to do that first of all, and how it actually affects the people, then about the jobs themselves. Right, the people. Alon tells you, gives you this example of when Trump announced that coal is coming back, we're bringing back coal, the industry is returning, then coal miners just quit the retraining jobs. Because yes, retraining jobs take a lot of time. I will take closing, but not yet. Retraining jobs take a lot of time, or a lot of effort. Interfere when, as Hila says, these are not high-paying jobs to begin with, and you have to work full-time and sacrifice your health for back-breaking hard jobs, at which point retraining simultaneously is very difficult even to begin with, at which point people go, oh, but wait, the government is putting a massive sweeping policy, giving up a lot of money to ensure that I have a job and continue to have a job, at which point people don't go, oh, it might be someday replaced by automation, so I need to look ahead, but rather they go, I need to work full-time to take care of people, I'm just going to quit retraining. We say that this cancels retraining program, where the government does give them some subsidies in order to be able to maintain themselves while retraining, because they go, no, I'll just take the job and the government's going to make sure that I keep having it. No, thank you. Furthermore, we say that it is unlike that when a law tells you that but these jobs are going to be shittier, he's not just saying people might get fired like Hila misrepresented. He says conditions are going to be massively cut, because if you want to mandate that retraining is going to happen simultaneously to this, then corporations are going to go, okay, but we can't let you have this full-time job that we need you to have in order to compete with these cheap Bangladeshi workers while taking the same amount of vacation days, and the same amount of sick days, and the same labor leave, and all these kind of things, at which point they cut your conditions. You have to work longer hours, your health does get taxed in this, and you can't actually reasonably do the retraining in an effective manner, if at all. At which point, even if you mandate this, you're completely crushing retraining efforts. When they counter this with, oh, but where are you going to find money for retraining? Retraining programs already exist, as they say, which means that we likely already have found, but also taking some debt in order to ensure that people can move to a more sustainable job, rather than, as they tell us, do a short-term solution, which they will phase over time, which means that companies will cut these jobs over time before retraining is done, because it is to a large degree mutually exclusive with retraining, then kind of screws this as a whole. We're saying, invest in retaining, invest in infrastructure jobs if you really want to create jobs. Don't do this and hope that some infrastructure is going to exist. Because when they tell us that, but then corporations giving jobs is going to lead to more taxes and more infrastructure, if we're not doing the infrastructure now, it's unclear why we're not struggling and we're going to do it. If they want to create a job, then do it by investing in infrastructure. Right, I'll take closing.
Most of the country's budget comes from employment or job tax and not from company's tax. Here we allow the country to make sure its economy is stable until that point.
So, first of all, it is unclear if this is true, but even if for some reason it is true that the massive amounts of money these companies would pay are not the main thing, but rather the meager wages that they continuously decrease for employees, then we think that make that it is even more important to retrain them and ensure a future of sustainable jobs rather than having them lose those jobs in a couple of years and then losing all this massive tax that allegedly you say they're going to have, right? And then let's talk about about how this actually affects the environment, how these jobs actually affect the environment of the country itself. Because what Alon tells you is not being gave you is these jobs are massively taxing, especially product manufacturing jobs, to infrastructures like roads for transportation, like the local environment, not necessarily even on a global scale, but in Flint, Michigan, where they pollute the water to make it undrinkable for the factory. We say that maintaining them actually does still mean that you if they're telling us you don't have the money, that you do have to spend the money, because the local people who now have their environment polluted are usually the ones who are not as capable of paying for healthcare when cancer rates spike, or it's paying to purify the water of an entire region. These are government infrastructure that are then forced spending in that case, and are forced spending once people start dying. We're saying that this right. Continuous pollution is not an improvement in that sense, but rather a continuation of the of active taxation on the populace, both on their health and on their money, at which point we say, sure, retraining might cost money. The mutual exclusivity of retraining with keeping those jobs alive is not worth it. The money you get from this is meager at best when you have to compete with tax havens with little to no taxation and with places where you pay little to no wage whatsoever. The global competition is insane, at which point you're giving up most of this money to create the illusion of a stable job, which is not sustainable as they say, which you phase out over time as they say, which ruins retraining efforts as we say and are not engaged with, at which point a Keynesian economy of just building the infrastructure yourself is still a better idea because it costs you money as it would otherwise, but at least you're the one controlling the jobs. You can force people to go through retraining because you're the one in charge of these projects, and you're the one who can actually say these are the conditions, rather than companies cut this and ruin both the likelihood and the efficacy of people actually going through retraining. For all these reasons, opposed.